Hey everyone, Internet PCS Book Reader here. Today I want to talk about Living Planet, The Web of Life on Earth by David Attenborough. David Attenborough, I think, is the most famous naturalist that documents the wild animals in their natural habitat, or just nature in general. His name is kind of synonymous with the word nature. In another word, you can say he's a force of nature in the nature field. Please don't leave. Honestly, the prologue of the book itself is already interesting. It told the story of million years ago about how India moved and become part of Asia, how the animal from Asia and the fauna mingles and become part of each other biome, about how India still moves about 5 cm per year, and how the Himalayas are also getting taller each year because of it. And it's not just India and the Himalayas, a lot of our planet are moving and changing at a very slow pace, everything from the land moving or sinking and rising, and also the change in the sea. This is not a book about climate change, but just to be clear, climate change and these natural changes that happen is not the same thing. There are some dumb that try to attribute climate change as a normal thing to happen after all, which it's not. Just want to put it out there so people don't misunderstand. Then the book starts listing about what enabled living organisms like us to thrive on this planet. First we go to the furnaces of the earth, the volcanoes. The book paints a great picture on how fierce and awe-inspiring volcanoes are, especially the active one. All of that heat and explosion and poison, and under all that intensities, there's a chain that connected all these volcanoes that goes on even under the sea with some that we have not even mapped yet. These volcanoes ridges are one of the causes of moving land. Africa and South America itself, from the shape of their edges and the material of them, are deduced to used to be connected, but fractured at one point and move apart. They are in fact still moving apart even now. Some of the effects of volcanoes are not just these almost invisible changes that unless tracked we won't even recognize. Some of its explosion in a way has created legends that put the fear of nature into us. The 1883 Krakatoa explosion are known to be the loudest noise ever produced in modern era, and the 1980s Mount St. Helens eruption changed the land even before the mountain exploded, and created a force that is equivalent to 1,000 times more powerful than the Hiroshima nuclear explosion. But within all this destruction, volcanoes also bring life to Earth. Some worms, algae, spores, and even birds like Maleo from Sulawesi use volcanoes to hatch their eggs. Volcanoes might be the most destructive force of nature on Earth, but once they've cooled down for a bit, they bring a lot of life into the world. And speaking of cooling things, the book then goes from volcanoes to the Arctic and other much colder places. The chapter is not as explosive as the volcanoes. It mostly explains why even in extreme cold that kills most creatures that stays there, including us, there are still living organisms that thrives on minus Celsius condition. It explains how they live, how different they spread and produce their body heat, even from how they walk. Penguins waddle for a good reason, not just to look cute and funny, but also for survival. The blocks of permafrost ice also contain a lot of traces of the past, like mammoths that are found in Siberia permafrost that is melting due to climate change. And unfortunately, they also contain a great number of methane that is adding to the climate change due to climate change itself. It's fine, everything is fine. Then after going through the extreme heat and extreme cold, the next chapter finally led us deep into the forest. Here we start to see how an ecosystem works. How in a forest, it is not just the trees that are the most obvious since it's called a forest, but even the mushroom, grass, all the creepy crawlies, and all the herbivore, carnivore, and omnivore that is inside it took a big part in forming their own kind of society. This one might be the most boring for readers because there is a lot of animals that can use some visuals to enhance the experience, but it is still quite an interesting section. It even took the time to debunk a Hollywood myth about lemmings. It also shows how trees can even defend themselves by communicating to other trees that there's a caterpillar infestation. The other trees will then produce a chemical called tannins, which cause their leaves to taste bad to the caterpillars. There's also a short section describing the difference in how trees, birds, bears, and all the other forest inhabitants function between the hot weather and the cold weather in the forest, showing the abundance of life in a forest before we enter to the next chapter, the jungle. The answer to the question, what if a forest is much more humid and wet? Amazon is actually one of the most famous jungle. There is so much more variety in a jungle compared to a forest, despite the weather in a jungle are often more consistent in being inconsistent. It's either very humid, wet, or even wetter. This caused a lot of the creatures there, including the plants, to be so much harder to study. We still don't know what caused some plants to drop their leaves or why they flower. And while unlike fiction, there are no monsters waiting for you, watching from you from atop the trees. But a lot of amazing animals do spend their life in the jungle if unbothered. Leopard, monkeys, different species of toads, snakes, and squirrels, and many other animals inhabited the jungle. There are even some unique birds like the Argus whose eyes were bestowed to them by the ghost the Sierra. Then after discussing all the tall trees, in the next chapter, the book goes to the grass, where we look at smaller animals that live there and the animals that eat those smaller animals, the ants and the anteaters. We also go to America, where the peasants used to live more freely. Only when the British invaded the land, they needed the land for farming, but the peasants trampled everything in their path. So starting in 1830, the white invader killed all the bison, not only so they can farm, but also so they can reduce food for the indigenous people. At one point, they killed the bison just for fun and to show off how much they can kill. Each person can kill thousands of bisons, like Buffalo Bill Cody, that at the time got famous for killing 4,000 animals over the period of 18 months. Unfortunately, the grassland is where most poachers are still active even to this day. The animal saiga, for example, has been driven to extinction in China because they think the horns are medicine for cooling effects, you know, like water. But despite all the difficulty, the grassland still grows until it comes to an area where the land is drier, where we reach the desert in the next chapter. Desert, the place where the main character from The Little Prince crash landed, and notoriously the most annoying stage in JRPGs, are either dried cracked land or land of sand that used to be greenery around 5,000 to 10,000 years ago. But even in such an unfriendly environment, there are still lives that thrive in the desert. Besides the obvious cactus and camels, there's the caracals, the famous desert cat, and all the other unknown sea animals, like the Gila monster, the only venomous lizard in the world. These animals adapt to the heat so much that they save more water than us. Camel's dung is famous for being burnable immediately after it comes out, because it contains almost no water. That's how effective they are at saving water. The desert is also home to the only human that has evolved to adapt to live in the desert, the Bushman of Calamari, where unlike most of us, their fat are contained mostly on their butt, so they don't produce as much body heat as us when they move. Then from the dry desert, where not much is happening, we move to the air, where everything seems to happen. The spores and the birds that travel through it. There's so much cool things among all these creatures that spend their life in the sky among the clouds. Which brings us to the things that cloud brings in their travel, the water that goes into the sea. A must read section for those who think that we did not study water enough. The river, the sea, the ocean, and the creatures that live in the largest section of the earth. The book even covers areas like Mud and Aldebaran, the most remote island in the world, and ended with how some of them have adapted to a new world that we built without them in mind. I'm not that much of a traveler as you guys might have guessed from how much books I'm reading on a daily basis while making video about every single one of them, but there's always something that is soothing about seeing nature. It's one of the reasons why I like to read books outside. I'm glad that I read this book right after I read The Little Prince that has a reminder in it to take things slow, to appreciate the beauty in life and, in effect, also the beauty in nature. Well, the book itself is an accompaniment of the documentary that David Attenborough produced for BBC. I think the way it was written is amazing. It brings your imagination to life while also giving you more context to how our world works. If you try to directly compare it with the documentaries, it of course is not as good as all that HD visual of nature. The book tried to add some absolutely beautiful nature photography, but still it didn't come along with the shooting force of David Attenborough himself. So you can't really compare them. But this is still a great read despite all those flaws in comparison to the documentary. And if you didn't compare it to the documentary, it's even better as just a book about nature. Nature is filled with so much amazing fact after all, just the animals themselves have so much cool skills that is them used in a lot of storytelling from around the world, whether from Greek mythology to Journey of the West, from Spider-Man to Kamen Rider Black, from Terraforma to Solo Leveling. There's a reason why there's so much adaptation of animal superpower in fiction, because they are that interesting. Channels like Tier Zoo and The Frank has proven that even on a very specific animal, nature are amazing. Reading this makes me question even more why people go to conspiracies when the truth is so much cooler. I give this a 3.75. What do you think? Are you gonna read it? Did I miss anything? Leave your thoughts in the comment below and subscribe to the channel. That's about it.